Welcome! This is Dr. Plague, and today we'll be designing some oscillator circuits that you can use to create a clock signal for digital logic. Or maybe you just want to flash some LEDs. Or maybe you'd just like to have the oscillator as a dinner guest. Whatever floats your boat. I was looking through my junk pile of electronic components for something that we can have some fun with, and what caught my eye was this here, a 555 timer IC. I thought this would be good to look at since I plan on creating future videos that use this 555 for some other projects. I'll be showing you some pretty strange and interesting formulas in this video, and some of you may be wondering where these come from. Most of these formulas are common formulas that pretty much everyone who designs these 555 circuits use. But don't worry, if you are curious, I'll be making a separate follow-up video where I derive each of these formulas from scratch. And just a quick warning, that video will contain a lot of math, including some calculus, solving of differential equations, and Laplace transforms. But I'll make that as fun and easy to understand as I can. Also, for those that know about the 555 IC, you will know that the standard configuration for an A-stable oscillator can only produce a duty cycle of greater than 50%. In this video, I'll show you not just one, but at least three different ways to produce a duty cycle of less than 50%. As a bonus, I'll also show you a common way to create a duty cycle of exactly 50%. And explain why it may not always work. This should be a lot of fun, so please stick around. So, the 555 timer has several modes of operation, including A-stable, monostable, and bistable. Today, we will be looking at the A-stable mode, which can be used to create an oscillator, or clock signal. First, let's take a look at what the 555 timer IC is. This is a block diagram from the datasheet, and you can see it has 8 pins. Let's draw this on the board and see if I can explain how it works. If you look here, you can see we have 3 resistors in series from the VCC to ground pins, and they are all the same value. These 555 timer ICs are manufactured with different technologies, including bipolar and CMOS versions. For the bipolar versions, the resistors are usually around 5 kiloohms each. And the CMOS versions are generally much higher. They can be up into the megohms. But the point is, all 3 in any particular 555 will be the same. And, by the way, contrary to what some people believe, the 555 was not named for the 3 5K resistors. The name was arbitrary. Also, there is a 556 IC, which has 2 555 timer circuits within it, and it doesn't have 2 5K and 1 6K resistors. Now, since the 3 resistors are equal in value, they will divide the voltage into thirds, with this point being 1/3 VCC, and this point being 2/3 VCC. Notice that we have a control pin here, which allows us to override these 2 voltages if we choose to do so. We have 2 comparators here, which will output a high signal only when the non-inverting input here is more positive than the inverting input here, or here and here. Basically, it will subtract the inverting input from the non-inverting input, and if the result is positive, it will output a high signal, and if the result is negative, it will output a low signal. The outputs of the comparators are connected to the inputs of an SR flip-flop. The little circle here indicates that the output of the flip-flop is inverted. Because of this, the output right here will go low when the set or S input goes high, and the output will go high when the reset or R input goes high. Notice that the output of the flip-flop then goes through an inverter, so that the output pin here goes high when set goes high, and goes low when reset goes high. And I'm not talking about this reset pin, but rather the reset on the flip-flop. Now, we have two inputs here, a trigger and a threshold pin. The output of this comparator goes high whenever the voltage on the trigger pin is lower than 1/3 VCC. Assuming the control pin isn't overriding the voltages. And the output of this upper comparator goes high whenever the voltage on the threshold pin is higher than 2/3 VCC. Again, assuming no overriding voltage from the control pin. We will make this assumption from this point on, so I'll bypass the control pin to ground through a 10 nanofarad capacitor. So, basically, the output pin goes high whenever we supply a voltage lower than 1/3 VCC to the trigger pin, and goes low whenever we supply a voltage greater than 2/3 VCC to the threshold pin. By the way, in A-stable mode, we generally connect the trigger and threshold pins together for a single input. We also have a reset pin here that allows us to reset the device if we bring the reset pin low. Generally, we will just tie it to VCC to avoid any resets, but you can use it if you want to. We have one more pin here, the discharge pin, and we'll talk about that one later. Now, let's take a look at an example to show you how this thing works. I'm going to make VCC 10 volts, and the range for VCC depends on your particular 555, but they can usually handle 4.5 up to 16 volts or so. Let's create a triangle wave to send into the threshold and trigger inputs. I want this triangle wave to continuously toggle the output pin from high to low. Remember, I said we needed to go below 1/3 VCC to bring the output high, and 1/3 of 10 volts is 3.33 volts. So I'll just set the lowest point of the triangle wave to 3 volts. And we need to get above 2/3 VCC to bring the output pin low, which in this case would be 6.67 volts. So, I'll make the highest point of the triangle wave 7 volts. So, this triangle wave continues to change from 3 to 7 and back to 3 volts. If it starts at 3 volts, we are below 3.33 volts, so the output should be high. Once it rises up to 6.67 volts, the output will go low. And when it gets back down to 3.33 volts, the output should go high, and this will just continue until we stop it. So, let's wire up a 555 timer IC and see if this actually does what we think it should. I'll connect VCC and ground to pins 8 and 1. I'll connect reset pin 4 to VCC. I'll add a 10 nanofarad capacitor from pin 5, the control pin, to ground. Now, I'll connect the threshold and trigger pins 6 and 2 together. I'll create the triangle wave with a waveform generator set to an amplitude of 4 volts with an offset of 5 volts. Let's check this out on the oscilloscope. With no offset and an amplitude of 4 volts, we get a voltage swing from negative 2 to positive 2 volts. But since we are adding an offset of 5 volts, we can add 5 to negative 2 and to positive 2 to get a swing from 3 to 7 volts. And you can see that is what we are getting. We just shifted the wave up by 5 volts. Now, I'm going to disable the output from the waveform generator and connect it to the threshold and trigger pins. Now, I'll connect our power supply to the breadboard. I'm going to make sure the oscilloscope probes are connected to the input and output of the 555 so we can observe what happens. And I'll power it up to 10 volts. By the way, I did preset the power supply to 10 volts before doing this. Now, let's enable the waveform generator and see what we get. Check it out! The input signal on pins 2 and 6 is in blue, and the output signal from pin 3 is in yellow. We're seeing exactly what we thought we would see. The output goes high when the triangle wave drops below 3.33 volts, and goes low when the triangle reaches 6.67 volts. You can see we have a square wave for the output. Perfect! Now, depending on your particular 555 timer IC, you may need to add a pull-up resistor to the output pin, maybe 1K or so. Check your data sheet. You can see that if I add a 1K pull-up resistor, that the output gets closer to 10 volts when it is high. The lower output with no resistor is just due to a voltage drop across an output transistor. Okay, now let's make this do something useful, such as blink an LED. Most, if not all, 555 timers can supply enough current to drive an LED. So, I'll just connect one up through a 1K current limiting resistor. First, I'll disconnect the scope probes, then add the LED. And let's adjust the frequency to 1 Hz. And reapply power. Check it out! Not too exciting, but it's something. Okay, this is pretty cool so far, but we still have a problem. We need to supply a waveform for this circuit to work, but shouldn't the 555 generate its own waveform without needing one supplied to it? After all, isn't that one of the purposes of the 555? So, we know we need a varying voltage on the threshold and trigger pins to get an oscillating output. But how do we do this without using a waveform generator? How about we charge up a capacitor? You see, a capacitor is somewhat like a battery that we can charge up, and we can choose the rate or speed that it charges by connecting different resistors in series with it. So, let's remove the waveform generator and connect a capacitor from the input pins to ground. I'll choose 4.7 microfarads and call it C. Now, I'll connect a resistor from VCC to the input pins and I'll choose 100K ohms. You can see that current can travel from VCC through the resistor and into the capacitor to charge it. By the way, I use conventional current flow and not electron current flow, as do most electrical engineers. So, for me, current flows from positive voltage to ground. You may see this the other way around, but as long as you are consistent, it doesn't matter. Also, I am going to pull the LED down to ground instead of up to VCC, so that a high output will turn the LED on and a low output will turn it off. I'll reconnect the scope probes to the output and trigger threshold inputs. Now, let's apply power and see what happens at the output. You can see it starts out high when the capacitor has no charge, and goes low after the capacitor has charged to 6.67 volts. The LED turns on for a short period, and then off. But that's it! This is not what we are looking for, but this is called a one-shot. Can you understand why? We only get one shot at changing the output. So, after this capacitor has charged up, how can we get it to automatically discharge so we can make an oscillator? Remember that discharge pin I said we would talk about later? Well, now's the time to talk about it. You see, when the capacitor charges up and the output goes low, this node goes high because we have an inverter here. Since this node goes high, it turns on this transistor, which essentially acts as a switch and connects the discharge pin to ground. When the discharge pin is not connected to ground, it floats. So, if we connect the discharge pin right here, we can discharge the capacitor to ground when we reach 6.67 volts at the input. But you can see that it discharges almost instantly, so the output looks like it stays high with only short pulses to ground. This still isn't what we are looking for. So, how can we fix this? How about we connect the discharge pin here, so the capacitor discharges through the resistor? Now, don't apply power if you do this. Can you see the problem? We'll short VCC to ground after the capacitor charges up, and we never want to do that. So, what's the solution? We'll just add another resistor between this point and VCC. I'll choose a 10K. I'll call this one R1 and this one R2. Now, let's power this up. And looky there, we have a blinking LED, and we aren't using a waveform generator. Beautiful! Remember I said we can only generate a duty cycle of greater than 50%? Can you now understand why? First of all, if you don't know what duty cycle is, it is the ratio of the amount of time the output is high to the period of the complete cycle, times 100%. In other words, it is time high divided by the sum of time high and time low, times 100%. If the time high is greater than the time low, then the duty cycle is greater than 50%. In this configuration, the output is high only when the capacitor is charging, and the capacitor charges through two resistors, R1 and R2. But when it discharges, during the time that the output is low, it only discharges through one resistor, R2. Since the capacitor has to charge through two resistors, it will take longer to charge than to discharge, since it only discharges through one resistor. Make sense? So now, let's take a look at the formulas for choosing the resistor and capacitor values. The time low will be equal to the natural log of 2 times R2 times C. The time high will be equal to the natural log of 2 times the sum of R1 and R2 times C. Remember, I'll have a separate video where I derive these formulas for you. Now, the period will be time high plus time low, and we can pull out the natural log of 2 and C to get the natural log of 2 times the sum of R1 and 2 R2 times C. Frequency is 1 divided by the period, so that's our frequency. I already told you that duty cycle is time high divided by the sum of time high and time low times 100%. So, this is the duty cycle, and we can cancel out the natural log of 2 along with C. You may see the natural log of 2 written as 0.693 in data sheets and such. So, if we run the calculations on our circuit, you can see we have a time low of about 326 milliseconds, a time high of about 358 milliseconds, a period of about 684 milliseconds, a frequency of about 1.46 hertz, and a duty cycle of about 52.4%. Now, with these formulas, you can design your own timer circuits. Just make sure when you select R1, you make it big enough to handle the power dissipated through it, since the full supply voltage will be dropped across it during a discharge. The power dissipated through R1 will be voltage times current. The current through it will be voltage divided by resistance. So, when the voltage is VCC, that comes out to VCC squared divided by R1. For R1 equal to 10K and a VCC of 10 volts, we get 10 milliwatts, and most any resistor can handle that. By the way, when the circuit is first powered and the capacitor starts out completely discharged, the first charging of the capacitor will take longer than subsequent charges because it needs to charge from 0 volts up to 2/3 VCC instead of from 1/3 to 2/3 VCC. So, the initial time high will be given by the following formula. the natural log of 3 times the sum of R1 and R2 times C. Now, something cool we can do with this circuit, and be careful because you can really annoy people with this, is to connect a speaker. Let's adjust the values and add a couple transistors to drive the speaker. This will be a Class B amplifier. Can't forget to add a capacitor before the speaker to filter out the DC offset voltage. Wouldn't want that going into the speaker. And I'll add a potentiometer in here to adjust the frequency. I'll also reduce the supply voltage to 5 volts. And here we go!
That's really annoying. Can you knock it off? I'm trying to watch TV.
Sorry. So, anyway, knowing these values and using the formulas I gave, see if you can calculate the frequency range that we can produce. I'll give you the answer at the end of the video. Let's get rid of the speaker circuit and put it back to the way it was before we connected the speaker. Now, let's talk about how we can get a duty cycle that is less than 50%. First, and probably the easiest way, is to simply connect the output to an inverter. This sounds too easy, but it works. And make sure you stay within the voltage specification for the inverter. Now, another common way to get a low duty cycle is to add a diode across R2, like this here. What this does is bypasses R2 when the capacitor charges, so it only charges through R1, and when it discharges, it still only discharges through R2. So now you can adjust R1 and R2 for a wide range of duty cycles. Since there is a diode in the circuit, there will be a voltage drop across it when the capacitor charges, so it will change the high time slightly. This is the new formula for the high time, and I will show you where this comes from in my follow-up math video. Notice that VCC shows up in this formula, so unfortunately, the frequency of this configuration will depend slightly on VCC. Let's add in the diode and look at how it affects the duty cycle. I'll keep R1 at 10K and R2 at 100K with C being 4.7 microfarads. See how the duty cycle is less than 50% on the oscilloscope? You can also see how the LED is now off longer than it is on with the diode added. So this works. But what if we want to create a duty cycle less than 50% that is not dependent on VCC and doesn't use an inverter? There is a way I can think of to accomplish this, and to be honest, I've never seen anyone else do this. I'm sure that someone else has figured this out. I mean, I surely can't be the first to come up with this idea, can I? Anyway, this is what you can do. First, I'll take this diode out and start with the standard configuration and just add another resistor right here in the path of the discharge line. I'll call this one R3. Now, notice that we charge through 2 resistors, R1 and R2, and we discharge through 2 resistors, R2 and R3. This looks great, but there is a catch. Let's suppose we make all the resistors the same value. You might be tempted to think this creates a 50% duty cycle, but let's try it out. I'll use all 10K resistors. The capacitor charges up, the LED turns off, and it just sits there. What happened? You see, in the standard configuration, without this resistor, this point here is essentially ground potential when this transistor is on. But now, with this resistor here, this point is no longer ground. Ground has moved over here, and this leaves a path for current to flow through R1 and keep the capacitor partially charged. Let's take a look at this in another way. I'll redraw the discharging circuit. When the capacitor is discharging, the discharge pin looks like ground, so R3 goes to ground. And because capacitors block DC current, the capacitor here looks like an open after we reach the final steady state, so we can take it out of the circuit. And we are left with a voltage divider between R1 and R3. Assuming a high impedance input to the 555, the voltage on each side of R2 will be the same. So the voltage here cannot end up any lower than what this voltage divider allows. We need to get down to 1/3 VCC, so R3 must be less than 1/2 R1 to get less than 1/3 VCC. If R3 is 1/2 of R1, then R1 is 2 times R3, or 2/2, and 1/2 plus 2/2 is 3/2, so 1/2 is 1/3 of 3/2. Or something like that anyway. Since R3 is the same value as R1, this voltage will only settle down to about 1/2 VCC, and the oscilloscope proves this. So let's change R3 to 4.7K. And now it looks like we are getting about 25% duty cycle. So this works, but we can't go much lower in duty cycle than this. I've worked out the time low formula, and this is what I came up with. Wow, that's pretty messy. And I'll show you all the math and how I came up with this formula in my follow-up video. But notice that VCC does not show up in this formula, so the frequency does not depend on VCC, and that makes me happy. By the way, the time high formula is still the same as for the conventional circuit. And if you want to get technical, VCC will affect the frequency of all the configurations to a very, very small amount due to the small voltage drop across the discharge transistor. But this is negligible and you don't need to worry about it. Now, as a bonus, I'm going to show you how to get exactly 50% duty cycle. But beware, this doesn't always work. Actually, this really only works with the CMOS versions of the 555. What you can do is get rid of the discharge line, remove R1, and connect the output, pin 3, to R2. I'll also get rid of this LED. Now, when the output goes high, it charges the capacitor through one resistor. And when the output goes low, it discharges the capacitor through one resistor. With bipolar versions, the high output probably won't be the full VCC, but the comparators will still compare to 1/3 and 2/3 VCC, so we won't get exactly 50% duty cycle. I am using a bipolar version of the 555, and you might notice the duty cycle is not exactly 50%. In theory, with the CMOS versions, the high output will be at VCC. So, since the capacitor charges and discharges through the same single resistor, the duty cycle should be exactly 50%. You can also get just about any duty cycle by adding a couple steering diodes like this. And since we're using diodes, the frequency will again be dependent on VCC. Also, the frequency will likely change with the duty cycle due to using a bipolar version of the 555 timer. And we can kind of straddle a potentiometer here with the wiper connected to the capacitor. And if we adjust it, we can get pretty much any duty cycle. Fantastic! You might want to add a current limiting resistor right here to help with the extreme high and low duty cycles. And if you'd like, you can add a pull-up resistor to the discharge line and use that as your output. Wow, that was a lot of fun! And I'm sure you could come up with plenty of other ways that you could connect up a 555 timer. Thank you for joining me in the Plague Laboratory today. And be sure to check out my follow-up video on all the math behind the 555 timer formulas, coming soon. By the way, the frequencies for the speaker were about 216 to 631 Hz. Let me know in the comments below if you got that right. And I'll show you the actual results on the oscilloscope. Slightly off on the upper end due to tolerances and such, but very close. So, I measured 216 Hz up to 636 Hz. So, if you liked this video, then be sure to peck at that like button. And don't forget to subscribe and peck at that notification bell to be notified of all my new videos as they become available. Thank you, and we'll see you next time, right here on Dr. Plague! Now, let's make some more timer circuits.